The video games industry is one of the most innovative and fastest growing industries in the world. The men and women of this industry work tirelessly to provide entertainment for the masses, and some of these provide the music. Music that we love. Music that we listen to when we're enjoying ourselves playing those video games. Music that we love. Music that we listen to when we're enjoying ourselves listening to video games. Do we even know who these people are? No. Would video games be the same without them? No. What you're about to hear?
Good evening and welcome everybody to another episode of the amazing, super duper, stupendously awesome...
Everybody, welcome to the
Average Giant!
We're totally average!
Oh my god!
So average!
I'm one of your hosts, the Average Gamer, that's me. And joining me, as always, is Flooby McFlubblah.
You just... No, you know what? It's Rambo H. Cheeseburger the Fourth.
Oh, my apologies, Flooby.
But you can call me Giant. You don't mess with Rambo H. Cheeseburger now.
True. What are we playing tonight? I have never seen this screen before.
Yes, you have, you liar.
No, I have not.
Oh. We are playing, I guess, the new iteration of Phantasmal that I totally helped kickstart.
Did you?
Yeah, I totally threw money at it.
Oh, cool.
After we had it on the show... Huh. Within an hour, I took out my wallet and threw it at my computer and be like, give this man my money. He
Excellent.
Deserves it.
And people might remember that we had Phantasmal on the show like 3 weeks ago, but we have a huge update, and I kind of want to get Joe in on the call with us so he can kind of explain it.
Get with the flow, Joe.
Yeah, Joe.
Shwow.
Get with the quiet, yo. All right, here, we're going to call Joe now. Hopefully he's there.
Oh yeah, that would help.
Mm-hmm. Ah. Hello.
Hey, dude.
Hey.
How's it going, Joe?
Not too bad. Bit burned out getting ready for GDC, but pretty good. How are you dudes going?
Good. GDC, you're traveling for that, I would assume, yeah?
Yeah. This coming Sunday, New Zealand time, we'll be flying off to San Francisco.
Oh, so man.
It's gonna be exciting.
That's a long trip. Are you going straight to San Francisco, or do you have to take a second flight?
No, it's we're pretty fortunate. It's a direct flight straight to there. So
yeah.
I think it's 12 hours or something.
Wow.
It's not too bad. Like in comparison, like when I went to see my rallies over in Edmonton, man, that was like 12 hours to San Fran, then like 8 hour layover, then going to Vancouver, then Vancouver to Edmonton. That was shite.
My wife got
so
the best.
This is like a nice little leisurely stroll.
My wife got the best story coming from coming from New Zealand. She was in the north end New Zealand for 7 weeks doing something school related.
Oh, who was that?
It was my wife.
Oh, your wife went to New Zealand. Came to New
Zealand. Yeah, she stayed for 7 weeks, and basically what happened was that she was done. She was on her way home. So what happened was that she didn't really know exactly where she was going other than home.
Okay.
So she ended up flying from New Zealand to Hong Kong.
Nice.
Had about an hour and a half layover in Hong Kong. Then she went from Hong Kong to L.A. Then I think it was like a nine-hour layover in L.A., and then she went back to Calgary, where we are. So, in total, 39 hours in transit.
That's awful.
The only good news that came out of that was that she sat beside William Shatner on her way home.
Are you
LA.
Kidding me? The chef.
Crazy.
She sat next to the chef.
Yeah, too bad she didn't know who he was.
Really?
She told me, she's like, I think I'm sitting next to William Shatner. I'm like...
Yeah.
Are you?
Was it actually him in the end?
It was actually him because he was coming to town for the Comic-Con.
Oh, coming to Calgary.
He also made the worst joke in the history of bad jokes, but it was... And of course it just flew right over her head.
Oh, was it like a tricky joke?
Oh, it was a pretty lame joke, but it was awesome either way because he asked her... he basically asked her, he goes, so do you fly often?
And maybe it was like a line, dude.
He asked her, he goes, do you fly often? And she's like, no, I'm just coming home from New Zealand. I've been in transit for this long. He's like, oh, wow, that's a lot. He goes, yeah, I used to fly a lot for my old job, but not anymore.
Nice.
Wah, wah. Nice.
So,
like a reference to him.
Yes, it was totally a reference to him in Star Trek.
Actually, it's kind of good that your wife has no idea about any of that stuff. Otherwise,
it was
me sitting next to the chef, be like, ah, oh, hi. I'm a big fan.
Yeah. Apparently, he was like, that was the nicest person he's ever sat next to.
Oh,
and all he did was listen to his classical music on his iPod. Anyways.
So, Joe, I have a small question.
Now back to the game.
Oh, what am I playing?
Just one more thing about the chat, because it just really...
Oh, yeah.
Have you ever heard of his rendition of the Rocket Man?
Yes.
Yes.
I think we all have.
Yes, I remember watching that in like high school.
That was I only knew about it because of Family Guy, and then I saw the original.
Stewie does it.
Yeah.
The Rocket Man. Sorry. Carry on. Sorry, I just had to get that out.
That's fine.
No, yeah.
Shake it all off. That's all we needed.
Yeah,
we need
go.
The icebreaker with William Shatner.
I was just gonna ask Joe, what am I playing? Because this does not look like any kind of Phantasmal I've seen before.
Okay. Actually, what I might do is I'll log into Hitbox. But the game you're playing now is still at its core Phantasmal, but it's very much the next iteration. So the environments are probably the thing that you'll notice that are most different, right? So it's no longer kind of a haunted house thing.
Lightning went off and scared the bejiminis out of me.
I know, I gotta turn that down a little bit, actually. I think in relation
no,
to everything.
No,
it's, you leave
it's amazing.
That
oh, do you like that? Okay.
So
what have you noticed so far? That'll be interesting to find your perspective.
Yeah, no,
there's a lot more sound.
There's a lot more setting overall. Like, there's a lot of corpses here, and you've got, like, the corpse flies flying around them.
Were those dead bodies?
Yep.
Yeah.
They sure were.
Huh.
Sure were. The entire level's different. What? The entire level is different, and there are doors opening, and I don't know why they're opening. I had the head coming up because I was taking too long, but it has disappeared now.
Well, it's only if you... That works like the old one, so if you run around heaps, then that will increase your ruckus.
Ah, I see.
They can always like shoot it up and stuff like that.
I like
then
the
that will increase. But if you kind of walk around slowly or you stop, then it should be sweet.
Okay. So I picked up a key, but this is completely different.
So is the storyline the same? Just it's sort of
we're not even in a mansion anymore.
Flippy, yeah, we were in a mansion.
No, not at all. I'm just gonna turn down the volume on the thing.
Sorry.
Yeah, no, it's good. It's all good. Because there's a slight delay, so it sounds like I'm talking to myself. I'm going like, what am I talking about?
This is like
to answer your question, it's actually, the storyline's quite different now. So one of the things that we did after coming back from PAX is we revisited everything for design. And one of the kind of the things that came up was that the setting was super duper cliche. So, you know, the whole mansion-y thing with the haunted house has been kind of done to death. And then one of our guys, at the time, one of our testers, said, hey, how about the Kowloon Walled City? Because that hasn't really been used that much. And it's got a very rich... Do you guys know about the Kowloon Walled City? You heard about it before?
You can tell us again. Yeah. I know about it.
Oh, you do know
about
it?
Yeah.
Okay. So for those of you who don't know, it's basically... it's been destroyed now, but it was a slum city that was built around just after, I think, World War II. So at the middle of it was an administrative centre, like and a fortress, I think, an actual fortress from World War II. But after the World War II, all these refugees and stuff sort of streamed in from mainland China, and just started building around it. And there were all of these like apartment buildings, like really claustrophobically built together and stuff. And even, you know, the government was really afraid to even go inside. There was running water and electricity, but the police and stuff just wouldn't touch it with a 10-foot barge pole. So we had this weird little ecosystem, little community going, like their own little world, basically, and it was filled with like triads and druggies and refugees and stuff, but it wasn't all terrible. Like, it actually thrived quite a bit, and so we really liked that setting. And it just hit a number of things that we wanted to achieve. Like, first of all, it is pretty freaky and stuff if you look at all the photos and things like that, but it's also kind of got that east meets west sort of thing, because it was in Hong Kong and has the whole British Empire's influence and a bit of the Chinese aspect. So I mean, this may appeal to a broader audience as well. It may appeal mm-hmm. to an Asian audience a little bit more as well.
And so, you're right, this does look like it's a much more unique looking game.
So was it difficult to transition from
making a completely new world and
yeah
level?
Making it to a completely different world, yeah.
Yeah, that required quite a bit of changeover of all the art and stuff, and we used some things. I mean, the game, if you kind of look at the some of the photos of Kowloon Walled City, it's actually quite, really narrow streets and stuff. So I mean, we had to take a bit of creative license, obviously, in a game. If it's all really narrow, then it's going to be a bit hard to play. So we had to keep it wide and a little bit wider and stuff like that. So it's a bit of creative license, but yeah, we had to change a lot of things over. I was a little guy following you.
It's still procedurally generated, though, right?
It is still procedurally generated. The
all the good stuff's
that,
still there.
Yeah. Oh, yep. That's true. I've got to see a comment here from Vin Yamina. He says it looks a little brighter. It's definitely a lot more lighting and stuff in this one now. This level where you're, it's probably a 5 second delay, but you walk through like a bar and stuff just now.
Yep.
So inside, although most of it's procedurally generated, there are some template rooms where we intend to have some set piece events and stuff going on. Yeah. And the other thing too, I'll quickly just add in there, is the reason why the lighting I think is a lot better is because one of the guys who's working with us as the main environment artist, his name's Brian Bell. He's based in Detroit, but he has he's an ex Hollywood lighting director, so he's done movies like The Life of Pi, Riddick, Chronicles of Narnia, Benjamin.
Cool.
But like, if you look through his cinematography, I know like every movie that's on his cinematography.
Yeah,
it just happens that it's ridiculous. But his good friend is actually one of the developers who immigrated to New Zealand several years ago. So Brian, I think he's had a lot of flavor, and I think the lighting is definitely a bit brighter, but without exposing too much. And I think he's kind of, I have to credit him for giving a lot of the atmosphere, even with the randomization. Yeah.
You guys have done a bang up job. This is, I am completely lost and freaked. And I'm assuming that's really what you're wanting.
Be quiet, man. You're getting the Star Child, whatever his name is, after you.
All I'm doing is walking. Well, he comes after time.
What's the demon dude's name?
Oh, what did we call him?
The noise demon?
Formally, I call him the creepy kid is the informal name, but I think he's the dark child, I think.
Dark child.
have you gone through the portal yet, or?
No.
See the compass on the top right? That's always a direct line to the exit.
Oh, perfect.
And if you find a room with a creepy room, with a long kind of a hallway with lots of columns in it, then you're on the right. Yeah, there you go. So there might or may not be stuff around the corner, so.
You timed that very well with the lightning.
So Pupu Danny asks, can you give a hint of the plot and what are the ghostly creatures?
Oh, the hint of the plot and the ghostly. Oh, yep, from Pupu Danny. Good question. So, the plot has changed a little bit now, so we're retaining the major themes from the old one. So we had the original one, the kind of the Lovecraftian theme. So that's something we really liked. We wanted to infuse the aspect of things. And so rather than being I think the original one we were Vietnam did and everything like that. So what we've done is we based the story actually on a real life story. So we've taken the basis from that. So, you found something cool. So the story is that there was a lady back in the 1970s. Her name was Jackie Pullinger in real life, but in our one we're calling her Jackie Dillinger. And she came in from England. She was a missionary. And She basically wanted to go somewhere and help people out. So she went to came to Hong Kong, and she was just trying to find. She had like $5 in her pocket or something. She tried to find somewhere to help. She ended up in the Kowloon Walled City, and she started up a heroin center for addicts. And over the years, she just helped more and more people. But in our story, we're taking a bit of a twist. So we said, okay, over the years, this lady helps a lot of people, and over time, especially during nearing the 90s, she starts seeing more and more addicts coming in who have been addicted to a new drug, and are talking and muttering a lot about and hinting at weird stuff like a cult deep under the city. And so you come in as the protagonist, who is the nephew of Auntie Jackie. And in real life, what happened is Jackie actually was able to get into Hong Kong because her nephew was a policeman. But in our story, you, the protagonist, you're actually a private investigator. So, you know, you've kept up with your auntie a little bit. And over time, one day, getting close to the demolition of the Kowloon Walled City, one day she just disappears. And one of her helper comes to look for you and say, look, I can't find her. So the beginning of the story is you going to look for her. You somehow make it to the top of one of the shacks where she lives. You fall through the floor, fall unconscious. When you wake up, that's the start of the game. So it's all about, so similar to before, where you're looking for your auntie and you're also trying to get the hell out of there. So that's kind of the main storyline. And one thing that we want to do later, and we've kind of started designing this, is there will be a branching storyline as well. So that's going to be different every time. So the main kind of story plots, there'll be about kind of four or five different ones. And then there's also going to be two or three subplot points. So the permutations will be about between 9 and 12 unique ones. So every time you play through, you get a slightly different one, which will then shed light on the overall picture of the entire story. So that's kind of what we're aiming for. It's kind of what we wanted to do in the beginning. I mean, the story really is the kind of the, I think is really important with horror games. So we want to kind of make it a bit unique. So what one of my personal favorite board, do you guys play board games, by the way?
I do, though. Yeah, exactly.
You ever come across Fantasy Flight games, and in particular one called The Mansions of Madness?
No, I have not.
Never come
though
across that
I think
one?
I will be checking it out after the
you
show.
You should check it out. I bought that one when I went to Edmonton. I've been kind of like, prior to that, seeing it online and like really wanting it and stuff. But I finally went there and I bought it. And the cool thing about that one is it actually ran, the game master or the dungeon master can choose the main plot points of what's actually going on, and the players don't know what it is. And so we wanted to take that and kind of infuse that kind of thing into our game. It's a pretty simplistic system, but with the permutations and combinations between the plot points, you can actually get quite a bit of variety. So I thought, I would love to have that in our game. So it will change things like the notes that you pick up, and the plot will kind of change. And then over time, what we want to do is, because do you remember last time I mentioned that we've built in a system called the AI director, which kind of controls the general ebb and flow of the gameplay?
Yes.
Yep. So that will affect that kind of thing as well. So that's what we have planned in future as well. So depending on what you do, that'll affect the plot. The plot will then branch out and affect a bit of the gameplay as well.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
This is coming along amazingly.
Yeah, you reckon? Okay.
Yeah.
Cool. It's so hard for me to see. Like, when I play it now, it's like, oh, is this game good or not? I don't know. So it's great to have a fresh pair of eyes look at it after a while.
Was I mistaken? I picked up one of the health packs and I thought I heard the protagonist say something, like some voice acting. Is that something guys are doing or putting in?
That came over from the old one had that. So we had a guy, Sean, who's based in Kansas, who was helping us with sound. So we kind of kept those. I don't actually know where Sean is anymore.
No.
Kind of disappeared off the map, unfortunately. Sean, if you're out there, call me.
We're worried. So the question I have is that will there be for the final product, will there be a beginning cutscene to sort of put you through what you just mentioned about?
Yeah, the explanation.
The whole explanation.
That's a great question. We actually had planned like a little comic strip that we wanted to put in.
Mm-hmm.
Potentially, yeah, we may do a cutscene, but I think to begin with, we'll probably do like a comic strip sort of thing.
That's perfectly fine.
Yeah. Yeah, depends how much time and money we have.
Yeah,
exactly.
And when it comes to the storyline, so currently with this storyline, the city is now evacuated except for the ghastly remnants.
Yeah, the cult.
Yeah, that's right, the cult, and there's still some stragglers and things. One thing we would like to do, and it'll probably come in after the early access, which we are planning to in late March, is we'd like to, because we've actually built in the framework for it now with a new note system. I don't know if you found any notes yet, but it may look a little bit different. But that system, it's a third-party package that we incorporated into the game. That allows for dialogues as well. That's actually what it is for primarily. So we actually want to have some NPC interaction. So you might find like some NPC drug addicts, some junkies hanging around. So most of them will be incoherent, but you might find the occasional one that actually has some that might become lucid briefly, and you can talk to them, and that may, yeah, you might want to be a dip and kill them if you're that kind of person.
Mm-hmm.
And that may affect the gameplay as well. But if you talk to them, then that will change a little bit as well.
The game is brighter, and yet at the same time, I have trouble seeing some things.
Well, the big thing about what's going on right now with the game that I've noticed is that it is brighter, but you can also see a lot more stuff. Like, the rooms are larger.
Yeah, and much more detailed.
And the fact that there's no, like, so, like, the way that you've done this, the rooms don't look like the rooms don't look like they're recurring as much as they were. Like, do you have more rooms available for the procedural generation?
Yeah, that's a good observation, actually. So one thing, so we're using a second version of the procedural generation package, which is also a third-party one. But one thing that we have done is there are a lot more tiles now, especially with the walls and the ceilings and stuff. So I think that in itself makes it look like gives it definitely more variations. And one thing that Brian's done really well, if you look up at this big room that you're in at the moment, there's lots of signs and things around, but it's harder to see with this particular version, but if we were to make the rooms a bit bigger, you would see pipes and things in the ceiling, so there are things called concepts of inlays and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so the rooms look very different because of all the items and the variations and tiles and things like that now. So I think Brian's done a top job in that respect as well.
So one of the big questions in the chat is, why are you opting not to use the gun
you
found before? Well, that's very simple.
I don't want to kill myself.
Take one of the biggest risks in this game when you decide to use a gun. The reason being is because these monsters are blind, but certainly not deaf.
It's worth mentioning that we made a little bit of a change. So they're no longer blind. They have very poor vision. They're not blind anymore.
Well, now you're totally screwed.
How do I use the pills? The health pills? Oh, it might not matter.
Well, but you kept in the same deal where the dark child is brought in by sound as well, right?
No, so he basically, if you shine a light on him, he will disappear apart from his eyes, which you can see, and you can kind of hear him as well. Have you actually come across him yet, the dark child?
Nope.
Oh, okay.
You can
actually hear him. You can hear like a buzzing noise from quite far away. But if you come, it works similar to before, so if you have a light shining on him, you can only see him when the lightning strikes, and he's more prone to coming towards you.
What?
Huh. So how can you use the health pills? Is that a thing I can do?
Oh no, it does say, I think we haven't updated all of those, but
say
sanity pills, but it just gives you instant health. It's, yeah, so it doesn't really, it doesn't help with anything else. You can't store it as well.
Totally fine with that.
Yeah. We actually, that's worth talking about too, is the sanity mechanics currently. It's just kind of limited to, like, if you look at something, then your vision sort of goes away. So we did at one point have, in the pre-alpha, a thing where your sanity would kind of gradually wear away and it would be very slow to come back. So you start seeing things and hearing weird noises or you start hallucinating and things. So that's something we're planning to bring back as well.
Oh, good.
not the current one.
So basically, if you can use your gun now without having too much issue.
It's similar to before. So if you fire your gun, there's kind of two negative effects. One is it's really loud and it'll track kind of all the creatures that can hear well. And then the other thing is there's kind of a global sound meter, which we call the ruckus meter, which is that little demon-y face. So yeah. If you make too much sound and just piss too many things off, then the sleeper, which is the kind of the outer god type monster, will come and hunt you. And at that point, you just have to get to the exit immediately, or you'll die. There's no way of killing him.
Yeah.
Oh, and the next question I have is that in the original concept of the game, you said that you were planning on introducing a crafting system. Are you going to do that still, or is that scrapped?
I think we're going to scrap it. I think there's not enough time to, and I think even the XP system, we're not going to have enough time to build that in as well. But I think one of the things that we kind of thought about over time was those are kind of, I think everyone's doing that at the moment, so it's, you know, it's not really going to add a lot.
Yeah.
And so we've decided to focus more on developing the story and essentially using that to give the players a sense of progression, especially since if you do finish it, you know, one time through, then you'll see a bit more of the story. So that's kind of what we're hoping will keep players hooked.
I personally believe that it's a good decision that you would remove the idea for the crafting system, because at this point in time, you're so focused on what you're doing, on going forward and not getting your ass eaten, that if you went into a crafting system like The Last of Us, I think it would actually take away from the overall atmosphere that you're immersed in. Because then usually when you get into a crafting system, it pauses the gameplay around you so that you can just do your thing.
Really?
Yeah.
All right, here. Yeah, so I've been asking.
I think it was probably for the best. Also, yeah, because this game to me is great the way it is, in the sense that you are constantly on the edge of your seat at all times. Like you don't want to stop because there could be something right behind you about to scare the crap out of you. So
where? What? Who? What?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
God.
Yamina says it would take away from the urgency, and that's exactly right. You don't.
Yeah.
This game is perfect with its overall sense of urgency and its impending doom.
Oh yeah.
It's like with the game Vanish that we've covered once.
Oh, that one that I beat.
Once or twice.
But yeah, we played Vanish, and with that game, you know, there aren't even weapons. You're just walking. You don't want to stop because there could be something right behind you.
Oh, you're creepy.
There's a comment there from Average Gamer about why the music. That's also worth mentioning as well. We've got a new guy, a new sound guy actually. He's really, really good with music and stuff. But he's just joined us recently, but he loves horror. So I said, dude, I really love Alien Isolation. So can you kind of take that and pick a few things and make it a little bit like that? So he's actually done a bang up job of making it sound similar to Alien, but not copying it completely. Borrowed some things.
Did you hear about the new movies?
The Alien movies?
Yeah, there's a new Alien movie. New Aliens movie, and a new Prometheus sequel coming out.
Okay. Is the Aliens one going to be like the James Cameron Aliens, or more Alien singular?
The one concept art that one piece of concept art that anybody's seen is like with an aging Hicks. So I'm hoping that it's the James Cameron Aliens, because that would be really cool.
Okay. Yeah, I wouldn't mind both, actually. I mean, I like both Alien and Aliens for their own merits. Yeah.
Yeah.
They're both unique.
Yeah, I heard the new Prometheus is going to be in, again, the same universe as Alien, but it's going to be, like, years and years after the...
Lady that's off on the thing.
The one that we all saw.
Oh, okay, yeah.
One big question that I have about one of the mechanics from the game previous was... You would duck, and if you ducked, then you would be you'd be fairly safe from monsters unless you got too close in proximity to them. Is there a point to ducking right now?
Yeah, absolutely. So you're right. So you can kind of hear like a footstep whenever you're walking along. So each time, whenever you're walking normally, it will produce a sound. Or if you're running, it's even louder. If you're crouched, it's completely silent.
Yeah.
If you turn your light off again, then you'll be almost invisible, unless you go, you know, like you say, go right up to someone.
Or accidentally he'd throw the flare like that, 3 times.
Oh yeah, the flare now. You may have noticed the flare now will attract creatures. So yeah. Previously they didn't care, but now if you throw one, almost blind guys will actually congregate towards him. Unless you throw it in front of his face, then he'll know it came from you.
So with this new iteration of the game, is there still how much gameplay is available currently? Because I know the demo had three levels, not including the mansion level. The intro mansion area.
Oh yeah, the so this one now has 5 or 6. I mean, it's really, we can define, it can be infinite.
That was one thing, when we had you on the show with when PG was here, you said that you guys were probably going to stick to the 3 levels, and I was going to ask why, because I would love, like, you know, 5, 6, 7, 10, 15 levels of this game.
You just made me think about something. There's one mode that you can add to this game that would be perfect for possibly even a score run. Endless mode.
Endless mode.
Do an endless mode.
Oh, right.
So that
that's not a bad idea. Yeah,
you can also try to make it like eatable. Each level could be a extra or more difficult as time passes.
Yeah, absolutely. That's actually not a bad idea. We've always I've always wanted something like the Binding of Isaac, how you can have a the whole leaderboard type thing, but you know, that would be a cool idea to have an endless one, and it does get harder and harder. That could be a leaderboard, just to see how, you know, the furthest someone could actually get through.
Mm-hmm.
That could be quite cool too. Yeah, no, that's a good idea actually. I'll credit
this,
you with that one.
No, thanks. Yeah, because this game,
the giant mode.
Giant mode.
The endless giant mode. Oh boy, yeah. Yeah, for some reason I get the most creative when I'm watching somebody else play games. You also have to add Donkey Kong mode and Slappers Only mode.
What is Donkey Kong mode?
It's just a joke from GoldenEye 007 from the Nintendo 64.
Okay.
There's a mode where if you do a certain area in a certain time, then you get the cheat code, which is called DK mode. And basically all the characters in the game, all the NPCs, they end up with a big head and really long arms.
Right.
That resemble Donkey Kong.
So what is the reason behind the keys, either if it's implemented now or if it's coming in later?
Oh, it's currently in there now. So you may notice in some of those little rooms at the end, sometimes you'll see a suitcase. So there may be actually in the little hospital room.
Oh, wow!
There's a suitcase in there somewhere as well.
Yeah, that's some timing.
Yeah.
I see.
Now you can die.
Yes, it's for opening though. Sometimes there'll be some goodies in there, or some. Most of the time there should be something decent in there.
Machine gun.
Nice.
Oh god.
Sweet.
I like how you actually draw your board.
Yeah.
You have a
it's stuck in your belt.
Yeah.
Go away, you can't see me.
Oh, it's worth mentioning as well that you can now hold down the left mouse button to charge up a hit. And you'll hear like a breath being inhaled as you charge it up. And then when it gets to its maximum, you hear like a... And if you release it, it'll be much more powerful than a regular hit. So you can actually, if you sneak up to this dude...
Oh, yeah.
And smash him, and he'll probably die.
Love it.
He was smashicized for free.
Love it.
Nice.
That's a good little thing to put into the game. That's amazing.
Because you can use it if you're safe enough to use it.
Exactly.
But it can totally bones you if you're not.
Yeah.
Oh, you stuff it up. Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's great for kind of following someone off into isolation, and then if they're not around to any too many people, you can pick them off as well.
Yeah. Is there a reason that you would want to turn on these lights? Because I feel like it would just attract all the monsters. Or is that actually more of a, here you go, player, go kill yourself?
No, not at all. In fact, it's worthwhile turning those all on. Like, it doesn't affect your visibility at the moment.
Oh, okay.
We may change that at some point, but at the moment, if you just flip it on, it makes it easier to see. Plus, it kind of helps if you've been to that place before. Like, the light has a distinct little halo around it.
Yeah.
So you can tell where you've been before. Because one of the problems we saw before was people would really get lost. So that's just kind of a means to help mark where you've been. And also, on top of that, it also, if you turn on a bunch of lights in a place, then it's less likely a creature will come from that area anymore as well, if you have enough lights on. There's multiple benefits to having lights on.
Smart. Yeah, because now that they're no longer
great.
Yeah, no.
Great.
That the flashlight and light doesn't, you know, it affects them.
Yeah, yeah.
Too much light should bug them.
Yeah. Yeah, eventually we'll probably look at putting something in. But at the moment, the lights, it doesn't make them see you easier or anything.
Son of a bitch.
So you've only made it to the second level so far?
Yep.
Wow. It's so big now.
Yep.
It's crazy.
It has grown inside. Oh, planks! Plank, 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 plank. Too big. Schnit.
Nice.
Angstivity. Health? Oh, no!
Ooh, a note!
Oh, you can have a look at the... Oh, you can't pick that one up.
26th of January, 1993. It's a sad time. Over the years, I've built up this clinic from nothing more than an abandoned room and my naive hope to save souls. I know.
Can you read it like the shit?
Yeah. Wait.
I know. I should be happy. I can't read it from here.
The walled city has always been a haven for the downtrodden, the weary, the hopeless.
Captain, there appears to be some...
Con!
You just throw in the can somewhere.
Oh, so that was a note from my aunt. Interesting.
I feel better already. He's not Batman.
Oh god. Oh god. Oh god. You can just see a shadow in the doorway and it's creeping me out.
That is some Oscar winning lighting. So how did you meet that guy?
So Jeff, who's our kind of senior developer, he's actually from San Francisco originally. He immigrated over to New Zealand a few years ago, but his mates all kind of grew up there, and they all went in their different directions, and a lot of them went in games, and Brian went in the direction of movies. So because Jeff has kind of been working on this, it was kind of a cool excuse to get in touch with these guys again, and they were really keen. Like, Brian always loves games. He's always loved games. He's always loved, you know, the Call of Cthulhu. That was a role-playing game that they used to play a lot of.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Oh, so he was over the moon.
Go. Sorry, Joe.
Yeah, we you got the Dark Child.
You're on level 3 now. Nice. Nice.
Yeah, I think you're screwed, man.
You get nice. You got through.
Not.
I can see you cringing away, too.
Holy cow.
Okay, sorry, anyway, go on.
good job, dude. So that's
thank level 3.
Mm-hmm.
Keep clicking this thing by accident. Level 3, awesome.
So Pupa Danny asks, how does the use of a flare differ from using your flashlight? Does your flashlight give your position away?
Yep, good question. So the both actually do. So a flashlight, if you're shining it and you're kind of walking around, then it makes you more visible. So some of the guys who can see will see you from further away. The flare is different in the way that when you throw it, it actually makes some noise. So if you throw it and then these main kind of creatures are around, then they'll congregate towards that sound. Yeah, so that's the difference. But if you throw it and they're right in front of you, they'll know where it came from. So if you throw it and you're out of vision, they'll all go, okay, what's this? And they'll start congregating towards the thing. So you can actually distract them away. You can actually get them away from... you can make them go away from you if you throw it in the right position.
Hmm. And what is that lovely creature with the red eyes?
Oh, is that the one that throws the red fire?
Oh, good, good,
it
good.
It throws
good.
The red balls of fire at you.
I just had the same reaction I did as, like, almost bumping into a witch in Left 4 Dead. That's the only way I can describe that.
Oh, the Left 4 Dead witch.
Your lights on and seeing what happens around them.
Oh, good. That sounds like a... Well, why not?
So, the creatures make different noises now. Do all the creatures make different noises?
Yeah, absolutely. So we've tried to incorporate a few different sounds, just so they're quite distinct. Yeah, so especially like that dark child, like he's pretty noisy and you get him, hear him buzzing away. Because he is fairly dangerous, so we just wanted to give the player enough cues, like visually and audio cues, so that they know he's around.
Thank you.
Do any of the monsters have quiet clicking noises?
Oh, like the clickers from Last of Us?
Yes.
Oh, God. Oh, what have I done?
Would you like that?
No, I would not like that at all. That's why I asked.
It's going,
Okay.
I think it'd be good simply because your flashlight has a...
those eyes!
But your flashlight has a similar sound. Okay, I'm going to have to kill these.
If you crouch down and turn your light off, those guys... Oh, this guy. Actually, cool, you killed him. Oh, cool! Did you charge up your hit to kill him?
Yes, I did.
Nice. That was very wise.
Thank you.
Oh, yeah. These guys, the spitters are pretty dumb. So
that's good.
Dang it!
There's heaps of them. That's a pain when there's a lot. Like individually, a lot of them are pretty easy to kill, but it's the combination of them.
Yeah.
Oh, nice! Killed them all. Good job.
Thank you.
Have you also noticed?
kill it! Kill it!
Blue glow around them.
Yes, very, yep. Very helpful.
That is very helpful, right? Yeah, that's something we noticed through packs, expose, and... Oh, cool. Oh, see that little skull, that little head that you just revealed in the cupboard? That's actually the face of one of our backers.
Oh!
I got the last hammer!
It was actually a reward, so we put him into the game.
Oh, cool.
Oh, wow. That's an interesting way to put him into the game. I'm dead.
I only did the $25 backing, so I didn't get any of the special perks like that.
You're getting the bill that no one's ever seen before.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm totally fine with world exclusives with on the Iron Giants. <so. laughs>
Slightly bit of a perk.
Yeah, I can puff out my chest with that one.
Nice.
Since we've had a couple world exclusives.
By the way, you probably realized by now that the first level is pre-generated, so it's exactly the same. But I'll tell you what, I'll give you a little cheat.
Oh, sure.
J and K at the same time, you'll warp to the next level immediately, so you don't have to suffer through this all again.
Oh, nice.
Is that going to be a temporary fix?
That's just temporary for this deep build. Yeah. You can feel free to do that.
I'm just kidding.
You don't want... Yeah, you could probably go to level 3 or 4. Which one is it? 3? 1, 2, 3...
Oh, wow.
4, I think, will be a little bit different. I think 4 will be a little... There's another bad guy you've never seen before on level 4.
I'm just asking that because I do know of one game that we have played a couple times that he left in a thing where all you have to do is press Shift and 5.
Oh, that's not fair. Oh, that is so not fair! That is not fair!
That's creepy.
Behind.
Oh, Dark Child. As soon as I spawned in.
Oh, that's so creepy.
I see what you mean about the light. Holy cow.
This is
level... That's level 3.
But yeah,
I heard him first.
The one game that we played before, he left in a thing where all you have to do is press Shift and 5, and you automatically gain a level.
Oh, nice. That's handy.
Black eyes.
Hmm?
Black eyes.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I remember you telling me about that.
So I had a level 600 character in about 4 minutes.
Oh, jeez.
Nice.
But anyways, it's still a fun
game.
But
I think...
But we're talking about this game.
I think this is level 4. I hear water dripping.
Okay.
So with the game, are you descending into the depths of the place, or are you just going, like, you're just traveling randomly throughout it with the portals?
That's a really good question. In fact, yes, you are. You are descending, so you'll probably notice that there are no stairs up, so it's always down. So you always know that if you're going downstairs, you're progressing forward. And so in line with the whole storyline and everything, you're getting closer and closer to the heart of the Kowloon Walled City, which will eventually be... So we'll eventually incorporate some tiles here that looks more like the inner sanctum of the KWC. And then after that, one other thing we were looking to do is below the city, if that's the particular storyline that you've ended up with, will be where the Outer God or the Sleeper actually resides. So it'll be the whole H.P. Lovecraft of you know, the whole, I think, are you guys familiar with H.P. Lovecraft a little bit?
Yes.
Yeah, you know how it's like Rylea is all non-Euclidean and basically screwed up weird geometries and stuff like that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so we're planning on building something a little like that and as the final few levels as well, as you go further and further in. But you're sorry, to answer your question, yes, you are descending the whole game.
That's also a very different step from the first iteration, because you'd be going up stairs and downstairs and all over the place.
It's cool though. It's there's another game called Spec Ops: The Line where they use descension as a narrative device, where you're continually going down and it's representing the descent into madness as well as like descending into hell.
Oh, okay, that's pretty cool. That's pretty.
Yeah.
So basically, the further down you get, the more the walls will be soaked in blood and random goop.
That's what I'm getting.
Just weird stuff. One of the things we planned to do originally was, as part of the original design, was you would start seeing things like rifts in reality. So you see like an astral plane sort of peeking out through a wall, and then it will get worse and worse as you get further and further down. So that's something we will potentially look at after the early access as well.
Hmm.
So you get more screwed up as you get further in.
So, I did see the spiders.
Cute.
I'm noticing... It's probably just optimization, but at the beginning of levels, I'm dropping FPS a little bit, and then it kind of catches
up. Yeah, we still have some optimization to do.
Yeah.
By the way, when you started the game, do you remember which graphical setting you picked, or did you just use the default one?
I usually try to put it as high up as I can, so this is...
Oh, okay.
What is that?
Oh, it's nothing. Just walk forward and give it a hug.
A black cloud?
It's up.
Oh god, it's walking towards me! No!
Say hi. It's friendly. It's there to greet you. Be like, hello, I'm the president of the city.
You just gave me an SCP containment breach, like, flashback.
What, just because this is what looks like, what's his name, Crazy Larry?
Yeah, Crazy Larry. Okay, so... You and I.
You should try playing SCP Container Breach once, because you will probably poo yourself.
Yeah. Okay, that's not gonna work.
I've played SCP Container Breach twice. Once for 10 minutes, where I got so scared that I had to quit because I could not play it. I was so scared.
Really? Awesome.
God, no, God, no, God, no, God, no, like, God, no!
Sorry. To the point where it wasn't even fun. I was just so scared.
Oh, great. I wasn't watching what I was doing.
Ah, you're gonna get eaten now.
Son of a bitch.
Just run! Run, man, run! You can run!
No!
You can do
it! No! No!
Just keep going! Down, 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 down!
Run, you bastard! That's not the way! Oh my god!
Oh!
Oh my god! Oh, he's tired! Ah. Oh, you'll never get me! You'll never get me! No! Go, 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 go! Yes! I did it!
He managed to escape.
Oh, he was so close behind me. Those green particles, which means he was like within an inch of catching you.
I'm done.
How's your heart rate?
No, you must go. So the other time that I played SCP Containment Breach, I played it for 20 minutes, and I had no idea what I was doing or where I was going, and proceeded to be like, you know, it's not even fun.
Right, okay.
This game has evolved.
Good player or bad player?
I was...
In a very good way.
I was chatting to my roommate about my favorite horror games, period. And one of them is Outlast, because I think it has the perfect mix of jump scare, suspense, and atmosphere. Another one is Alien Isolation, though I feel like that one is more suspense than horror. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
SCP Containment Breach is... I always say it's too effing scary to
finish.
It's
nightmare fuel.
Yeah, it is.
It's pure nightmare fuel.
Very good. Very good. I played it for hours. Yep. But this, I think you just passed SCP. I have not been that stressed.
Compliment.
Yeah, no, completely. I mean, in the most positive of ways, but I have not been that, like, physically shaking trying to finish a level.
you're in
a
frightening
bedroom, too.
Yeah!
You need to find a way to get this to Markiplier.
Whoa!
Or, like, mention to Pewds that there's a new version out that's even scarier.
Yeah, I would love to see this back on YouTube.
Coming up to launch, I'd love to get Markiplier. Or it's just so hard getting hold of those guys. Like that, I think that thing with PewDiePie last time, we were very fortunate, but he's got so many people asking him for stuff all the time. I guess it's just hard to cut through to these guys, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, so if you know someone on the inside...
If I knew somebody on the inside...
Yeah, exactly.
Holy cow. That is thankfully going to bring our first episode... I can't even talk right now. You
thankfully,
do it,
our flight service...
Yeah, my hands are still like... Ugh.
He's officially turned into a walking spoonerism.
Yeah, holy crap. Thanks, Joe, for joining us.
Thanks for playing.
Yes.
This will be on a... Will this Twitch thing... The stream be somewhere I can...
Yeah, it should be up on YouTube tomorrow, if not the day.
And a quick question I have is that for the backers and for us, are you okay with this being Let's Play? Or would you prefer it to be under wraps for a little while?
Once the backer demo comes out, maybe.
Oh, yeah. So, for the time being, we need to release it out to our beta testers just to have a look at. We're kind of a bit behind schedule at the moment, but yeah, we need to release it to the Kickstarter backers first before we kind of release it generally for everyone else.
Well, I'm a Kickstarter backer.
So I hope everybody enjoyed that little teaser.
Sorry?
I hope everybody enjoyed that little teaser and everybody watching this on YouTube. Actually, we can chat about that. If you don't want this going up on YouTube, that's fine, too.
Oh, no, that's fine. No, don't worry about that.
Okay.
That's fine. So the video is fine. Just don't give the link out to everyone just yet. Wait for maybe another couple of weeks, and then you can do that. Yeah.
Okay, perfect.
Oh, no, we did that with Vanish, with their release candidate, too. Him and I are the only two people that have actually ever played that release candidate.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay. Awesome. Yeah, we also need to run it through a bit more testing as well, because at the moment it's a bit poop. So, mostly I think okay. There are just some little things with the AI and stuff that are still in our defect list and things. Yeah.
If you ever make physical copies, you should have a super special edition that comes with a free pair of pants. I need to go change.
No, just a pair of Depends, not pants.
Yeah, that'd do it.
Just put a diaper in it. That's all.
Yeah.
Phantasmal brought to you by Depends.
Live stream edition.
It'll be great. Right. It'll have Twitch on the ass.
Alright. Anyway, I need to go and hug a puppy or something.
And then we will be back with the next game, which is the Poobas.
With another amazing exclusive.
World exclusive.
The people that brought us Concursion.
World Star Hip Hop exclusive. What?
People that brought us Concursion, one of our favorite platforming games of last year. We're going to be playing their follow-up title. So stay tuned in the next couple of minutes. We're going to be checking out the Weaponographist, and we have both the Poobas that are going to be in the call with us.
Ooh, both? Whoa!
Yeah! But yeah, thank you again so much, Joe. And we'll keep in touch because I need to see what happens with this game.
we'll keep you in the loop, and thanks again for today. It was heaps of fun and absolutely loved it.
Yeah. All right. Have a gooder.
See you
guys. Take care. Bye-bye.
And we'll be back in 5 minutes with some more super awesome advertising.
All right, we're back. Hi.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah. How's it going? So we're gonna be playing the Weaponographist.
Brought to you by Wendy's. Wendy's. I don't know what's their slogan.
If you like fat, come and eat some burgers.
If you like fat, eat some Wendy's.
All right, we're gonna call the Poobas, some of my favorite peeps. And we're going to get this going.
The Poopa Peeps?
The Poopa Peeps.
They're actually made of yellow marshmallow.
Mmm.
Yes.
They're an Easter time treat.
Yes, they are. And they're hilarious to put a whole bunch of them in your mouth. Brought to you by Poopa
Hello?
Peeps.
Hello? There, I think we can hear you guys. How's it going? Hello?
Hey, is this an audio-only call, or are you looking at me in my underpants?
This is an audio-only call. You're good.
We're just going to tell you it's an audio-only call and then zoom in.
You'll have to zoom in pretty far.
What?
Bam, 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 bam. All right, and we should have... Perfect. So, how's it going, guys? It's been a while. Not really that long. Like, 3 or 4 weeks?
Yeah. It's been forever, man.
I am gonna reset progress. So before we start, congratulations on the launch of Concursion, which is amazing. Tell us a little bit about your follow-up title, The Weaponographist.
Yeah, Danny. We lost Danny. Or maybe he's testing me. I could tell you about it if you like.
You know, whatever works for you.
I was talking for a while throughout the conversation. My mic's not plugged in. I'm a dumb.
See, I know from experience there's no way that Danny wasn't talking that whole time. So
I'm a dumb.
It's okay. I've done that live too many times.
Wait, set me up again. Let's pretend that never happened.
All right.
Just rewind.
So welcome back to Everjet.
Welcome to Everjet. Brought to you by Wendy's. It's full of fat and deliciousness.
We're going to be showing off another exclusive, which is amazing. We had a really fun show today.
It was a World Star Hip Hop exclusive.
Yep. World Star Hip Hop exclusive from the Hip Hopopotamus and the Rhymenoceros.
Oh, it's the mother flipping.
Sorry. I don't know where we're going with this.
No, the only rap I
do
will
it,
ever
giant.
Do. I will do the alphabet rap from
really?
Black Oasis.
Wow.
I'll try. I've never done it before. I'm sure I can do it.
Okay. Sure, we'll have a little treat.
Go.
Let's put him right on the spot. Here's the spot you are now standing upon.
Alphabet aerobics.
And we can see the intro at the same time.
Okay, so I'll do the first couple lines for you, but I'm just reading off of AZ lyrics.
Okay.
Okay, now it's time for a wrap-up. Let's give it everything we got. Ready? Begin. Artificial amateurs, aren't it all amazing? Analytically, I assault animate things. Broken barriers, bounded by the bomb beat. Buildings are broken, basically I'm bombarding. Casually create catastrophes, casualties, canceling cats. Got the canopies collapsing. Detonate a dime of dank daily doing dough. Demonstrations, dawn data on the down low.
Nicely done. I just saw Harry Potter do that on the Jimmy Fallon show.
Yeah, and that's why it made me want to be like, I want to try that.
Yeah, but, okay, we have some amazing art going with the Weaponographist.
Oh my
I
god, that guy had derpy eyes!
So, we have the Poobas in the call with us. Why don't you tell us a little bit about the follow-up title to Concursion, the Weaponographist?
Yeah, I can do that now. Yeah, the Weaponographist, it's, I guess, a high-speed, top-down dungeon crawler, and you play as Doug McGrave, who's kind of this world-famous demon hunter, and just unrepentant jerk butt. And so, for refusing to save kind of a poor demon-besieged city for free out of the goodness of his heart, he's cursed. And due to this curse, all of his power and his weapons and his strength are basically constantly bleed away from him. And the only way to combat the curse is to kill enemies and save the city as fast as you can. And so it all kind of revolves around running over, killing an imp, picking up his spear, using it against a swordsman, using that sword, killing a gangster, using a machine gun, and just running back and forth between enemies as fast as you can before the curse kind of takes hold and saps your strength.
I love it. I love...
Oh, there's voice acting time. Is it voice acting time?
Sure.
Oh, it's me.
Go ahead, Chester.
Okay, I gotta see what Chester looks
Step
like.
Up.
Oh, I got it. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, this is a good one. That's perfectly fine, you know. He'll be okay. These little wooden guys love to get smashed. Give it another go. Try your new sword out on this guy. This is Mustache Man.
Okay, I got the next one.
Just sacrificing his pets to teach you a lesson. He's
kind of Cummerbund Rose Patch. A magic spell. Those happen to be my specialty. Go and pick it up, Douglas. Now press space to cast the spell.
Oh my god,
that works differently, you know.
That's friggin' Prince.
It is Prince.
I didn't say that.
That is the mage formerly known as Prince.
Actually, I need to correct you guys. It's Little Richard.
Oh, okay.
Great Rings of Fire.
No, it's Rick James. Come on, you know.
Fantastic! Alas, with this curse, all your weapons are likely to shatter after a few attacks. Luckily, they have lots of weapons down there. You may as well get in there and save us, I suppose. We've rattled on enough already. Good luck.
Grumble, grumble, grumble.
Amazing! So tell us a little bit about the art, because the art in this game is stupendous.
Thank you. Thanks so much. Yeah, we're really, really lucky to be working with a handful of really great artists. So you guys probably know I'm a terrible artist, and I won't speak for Dave, but, you know. And yeah, so we actually hooked up, met a gent named David Logan, who works at an animation studio just near us, and he ended up introducing us to a whole lot of friends and buddies. So we ended up working with a team of, what, about seven people working on enemy animations and hero animations and cutscenes and things, and yeah, I gotta say, it's really, like, if anybody needs art, these people are great. Really,
yeah, like,
great experience too.
I love when the dudes with the Tommy guns die and the goo. I don't know how else to say it when they turn into the green goo.
They gooify.
Yeah,
it's that's officially goo.
It's gooify.
It's now a verb.
It's the gooping. The gooping it like that.
You're losing your levels, man.
You're gooping out.
Gooping
this
out.
Is such a crazy idea for a game where you are getting worse.
As you go
unless
on.
Unless you fight. I just think that's so different and amazing. Like,
I'm just glad that I get to use a Tommy gun on headless swordsmen.
This is an anti-game.
I really like being stressed when I'm playing a game. Forced to go faster. Forced to, like, do it better. And so... Yeah, I really like the push and pull. Just like you have to go fast enough to keep your level, or you get weaker. But
this is
too cautious.
This is an anti-game, and you're an anti-hero.
So tell us a little bit about the goop mechanic, because that's one that I really like too.
How about them goop physics?
Well, the way that goop works basically is it's inside all the demons, and then when you kill them, it oozes out. Because it's liquid evil. But no, seriously, the Doug can't hold anything of value, can't keep currency. Any weapons that he holds will eventually explode. So the people of town, the NPCs, the vendors, they've agreed to accept demon goop as currency because it has no other value, really. So because they want to help you, but they're not going to do it for free. They're not going to do it unless you prove that you're doing something valuable. So the more demon goop that you collect,
like you originally threatened. Yeah, doesn't really want to be here, so they're constantly like, "Well, we trust him for now, but he better show results." Like, this is the best means he has.
And also, Chester can feed it to his chests, which makes the chests grow runes inside, basically like magic poops.
Oh, cool. You gotta do something about the
So essentially what it does too, we get to show it here. Ooh, highest combo. So it isn't just goop. I'm picking up all the best bits and pieces. Like, oh, they have rings in this ear. I may as well take it with me.
Only the most choice remains.
Oh,
that eyeball specifically.
John Smith.
Really nice.
John Smith?
In quotations.
Oh,
purposefully in
this
quotations.
I got this one. Welcome back! Looks like that curse got the best of you, eh? Let's talk about that real quick. Killing enemies will make you stronger. The higher your level, the more damage you do.
Okay, I've got girdle builder.
Are you sure you don't want me to do some lumpy?
No, I got it.
Okay.
Plus, training at your weapons with me will make you hit even harder.
I did not see that coming for her.
Ooh, but beware. Because the curse, whenever you aren't slaying evil, you're getting weaker.
Enemies will increase your combo meter. But if your combo meter ever reaches zero, your experience will quickly bleed away, weakening your strength. The number of kills in your combo doesn't matter, but you'll have to keep it active to avoid losing experience. Now do everything you can do. Yeah. Do everything you can to slow that curse down. Like, give me all the goop you find.
Thank you, Dr. Wily.
It always has to end with nyeh.
Nyeh.
So yeah, the flow of the game basically is, you know, get into the dungeon, do the best you can, kill as much as you can, and every time you come back, you get to spend your rewards to get a little stronger, train your weapons more so you can do more damage with all the different weapons, pay John Smith to slow down the rate of the curse, all sorts of different weird upgrades and spells and magics.
I like it. Do you want to do Bard Follow Me Bard Cakes, or should I?
Because I could do this.
No, I think I got it.
Okay.
Oh, that's right. Okay. Hey, Doug! You want to learn more about how this car stuff works? I got tons of info on it. Come see me!
Yeah, thank you.
You know we're recording all of this for use in the game.
Oh, yeah, please do!
Hi, Mr. McGavel! I'm writing down everything all about your adventures. If you need to remember something or see how you're doing, talk to me!
Ooh.
I am writing things down. Look at that.
Yeah.
Thank
you.
Look at that. All the
thank you for
the
writing
time.
Hey, there's It's Gimme. I saw him. Good streaming friend of ours.
Mr. Gime.
Okay. It's been a while since I reset my progress.
By the way, if you see me go really close to my camera like that,
it's because you're trying to see.
It's because I'm trying to see past the microphone.
Are you trying to see me? Can you look right through my screen?
Maybe. Like the ring. Yeah, I'll just like keep going forward and forward.
Oh! I should punch you, dear man.
The new Mega Man character, Punch Man.
I feel like Guts Man was that, or maybe Hard
yeah.
Man.
I saw a really good comic book or comic where they made Cholesterol Man. And then he absorbed his power and had a heart attack and died. And Wily was just like, finally!
I've never seen that. You just need to send Kamikaze Man. Nobody wins.
Amazing. So what was the kind of the inspiration behind this game? Like, what made you guys go, you know what? I want to make, like, this kind of arena dungeon crawler, but I want a troll player, so... They're gonna lose.
We decided long ago that we hate our players and we don't like being happy. The design process?
You're the guys that made Vanish as well, because I think they said that too. Except they were being serious.
So this game started as like a 3-week brainstorm, and it was a lot of things before it was this. And
really?
I don't even know how we got to this, actually, but I remember where we started. It
was
really
saying,
ridiculous
started,
stuff.
Yeah. So it started as we wanted to kind of explore the idea of kind of a classic role-playing game with, like, you know, elemental weaknesses and, you know, turn-based menus and things and, like, a complicated, you know, rock, paper, scissors of weaknesses, but in real time. And so, like, if you ever played, like, Quest 64, something
yes.
kind of like that, you did. Why did you play that?
Wasn't
I
it
played
one
a
of
lot
the,
of
wasn't
crap.
It one of the first titles for N64?
Yeah.
Yeah. And so it kind of started in that vein, and more we like started simplifying and reducing it and kind of like trying to distill out what we thought was fun in that. It was like, you know, having to adapt to things in real time, and I didn't want to slow down and have menus, even though we had this kind of cool concept for how to do them quickly. It was just a constant refinement process of like, all right, let's drop that. That's not the core of it, until we found like, all right, this is the part we think is the most fun. And we ended up with Token Grave.
Oh, interesting. What were some of the other iterations, if you don't mind me asking?
Yeah, I'll share like our most blown out one, unless you want to do anything in possession.
Yeah, I'm kind of afraid to let loose some of the concepts that we had in case we want to bring them back someday.
Sure. Yeah,
there's
no, that's
there's
fine.
One in particular awesome. That I'm thinking of that was really, really ridiculous that I want to talk about.
Do
I'm
you think you
Yeah.
Do it, share it.
Oh, yeah, we're never going to make this game. This Weaponographist was almost a game called Football Helmet Jones, where basically the main character is lives in like a semi-realistic city, and he is, let's say, misunderstood, sort of a rambunctious preteen, and he, in the beginning of the game, was going to don a football helmet and crash through the wall and just start literally killing people by headbutting them. But as it turns out, pretty quickly thereafter,
through them like butter.
The whole town is full of evil. Like, but you don't
oh,
really know
course.
That as a player. He's just headbutting everything.
Hey, Giant.
Oh, sorry. Having trouble down there? Our new health upgrades will surely hit the spot. Yeah.
Yeah.
Danny, how did we get from Football Helmet Jones to the Weaponographist?
Yeah.
I think we both really like the genre. We're looking for ways to keep it really fast. I think we have, similar to the curse, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think we had something like kind of a rage meter, momentum sort of system, whereby like as you tore through people, he'd gain momentum. But,
Man.
Down. Like, you couldn't charge people. Basically, the people were like made of butter, and they would just blow apart as you ran through. And, that eventually became, or maybe it came first, this. Maybe that was a refinement of, we were talking about doing it as kind of a possession-based game, whereby instead of killing your enemies, you kind of have the option also to weaken them and eventually take over their body, and you'd have all their abilities, and it would, like, you know, totally remap what you could do. And we ended up keeping that with the idea of the different weapons you pick up to some degree. But it ended up being a little more complicated than I wanted. It was like questions of, we had a lot more stats, and it was like, okay, only if your wisdom is greater than, it's kind of a Pokemon system. If your wisdom is greater than their strength, but if you, as you weaken them, you know, you can possess them sooner, because it was kind of like, if you could wait to possess them till they were almost dead and it'd be easier, but you'd be almost dead. Or you could possess them when they had a lot of health, but it'd be harder to do. And it was too complicated. It was like, it took too much explanation.
Plus, I could swear that game exists, and we couldn't put our finger on what it is. Like, it's not Legacy of Kain. It's not like,
I was gonna say,
there's
I just found, you might be thinking of Messiah.
Oh, I don't know that. What is it?
You played a little cherub, like an angel. And the mechanic in the game was you'd have to take people over to try and, like, beat puzzles, and it was a shooter. So
I've
you had to take...
Where'd I go?
No, I was just going to say you had to take people over to, like, to use different weapons and that kind of stuff. I just found it. I was thinking of installing it and playing it. It's kind of weird that it came up.
I saw an interesting one that reminded me totally of the concept this week. It just got posted, or I don't know if just, but it's on itch.io. It's called Midboss. And it's like a procedurally generated dungeon. You can possess enemy after enemy and kind of, almost exactly what I was saying.
Mm-hmm.
Which is cool.
Interesting. Well, I am a huge fan of the Weaponographist. I like how this has turned out already. I mean, you guys always have. I think, sorry, I'm like saying like five different thoughts here. When we had you on for Concursion, the one line that always stuck out to me was, it's like, you guys are really good at taking a palette of mechanics and then seeing how many different colors you can make with that palette.
I like that.
And this game has not betrayed that way of thinking for me. It's really interesting to see how much stuff you guys have thrown together and seeing how it intermingles in each room.
Thank you. How far have you gone so far? What's the deepest depth of the dungeon?
I've gotten... I'm not gonna lie, I'm not Killer PG, so I'm not good at Binding of Isaac, so I've beaten I had beaten the first boss, and then I haven't installed the thing from the last email, because I have been playing this game for a little while, but I'm not going to say all that stuff.
So many mysteries.
I've never played it before.
I swear, I didn't die this time. I just decided to come back.
He has to visit Girdle. You gotta get them weapons.
Yup.
Welcome, laddie. If you want weapon lessons, I'm the one to see. Train with me and your weapons will pack a bigger punch. I can... Sorry, I had something in my throat.
Okay, now do your bubblegum.
That's hilarious. In my head, she's got like an Irish lady's.
Oh, then I'm gonna switch it over to a sarcastic valley girl.
Yes, do it.
Welcome, Lottie. If you want weapon lessons,
which valley is this?
It's from Adventure Time Valley.
I'm the one to
I
say,
guess.
Train with me, and your weapons will pack a bigger punch. I can teach you to wield that junk like it's diamonds.
Amazing. Well, what should we hit hard with? Fist and sword?
Or you could do the smoking Boston one.
Oh my god.
Oh my god, Sheila!
Mrs. Bighead from Rocko's Modern Life.
I was thinking of Paula Baldwin.
Did you say that's come up twice in the past 2 weeks?
Rocko's Modern Life, yes.
Yeah.
Linda Richmond?
That's not her name, is it?
From Coffee Talk, yeah.
Linda. Oh, it's Linda.
Oh my
I know
god.
That, oh, sorry, Paul Baldwin was the guy, and Linda Richmond was the woman.
Right, she was filling in for her.
Like, oh, okay, yeah, because it was Paul Baldwin with Coffee Talk.
Yeah.
We could talk about Boston, we could talk about coffee. No big whoop.
No big whoop.
Hi, Rocko!
Hey, Spunky, I'm a sad, crying clown in an iron lung.
Oh my god! Nobody in chat is gonna know what we're talking about, but that is one of my favorite shows growing up.
Yeah, I watched that way too much. Although I probably did not understand much of any of it, considering that I didn't know that Rocko worked as a sex phone operator.
My wife and I watched it back in 2010.
I thought
he
was a telemarketer.
Nope.
He's
he sure worked at a call center, but it was more adult.
He worked at an adult call center.
Watching the show now, it's a completely different show. That show is more adult-oriented than Ren and Stimpy. It's ridiculous.
Wasn't that on, like, CBS?
It was on, well, it was on YTV for us, which literally stands for youth television.
But it was so, like, the adult references are so obscure that you couldn't even tell.
They got away with it.
Yeah, like, the only thing that I thought was a bit more risque at the time when I was a kid was Powdered Toast Man and his nipples of truth.
I
you have to grab onto
comments.
My buttocks.
Are you clinging tenaciously to my buttocks?
Oh, sorry. Who's
okay.
this? Oh, that's
Chester.
The same guy. You've actually met that old witch outside town? She sure never shows her face around here.
Rubble, rubble.
Rubble,
rubble. Rubble. Oh, there you go.
We vendors know you can't carry money, so I'll take the demon goop. Bring me some and I'll send my little pals into the cave. Give them a good whack and they'll drop presents. Don't worry, they love it.
You almost sound like Nixon from Futurama.
I need more jowls for that.
You more
gotta
jowls.
Get that face wiggle in. The whole face has to wobble.
I can't do that with these headphones. I have to take my headphones off for that.
Alright, let's do this. I'm loving this. What's that, sorry? So, I like the idea of the demon goop simply because, much like Rogue Legacy, it gives you kind of that semblance that, for people like me who aren't very good at the game, it gives you enough progression that it makes the game easier over time, so you're going to see more and more of the content, which is cool. I like that.
Our hope was kind of like that somebody really good can maybe get through with really minimal upgrades, but everyone's kind of on a collision course with success at some point.
Yeah.
You succeed through failure or through being, like, the way Danny plays it, is miraculous, and I honestly don't understand how he's able to do this, but he gets all the way to the end with, like, dying, like, three times, which is impossible.
Good God.
Take a look at the picture I posted in chat.
Be hot, be naughty, be courteous.
Oh my God.
Yep. There you go.
I didn't get that as a kid.
No, I know.
Did we just ruin you? If we did, I apologize.
Time and loose women ruined me.
Oh, wow. I also just noticed that these goblins have little, like, bunny slippers on.
They do. They're fresh out of bed.
Yeah.
They honestly, they'd rather you never came to their dungeon. They're, you know, all about getting a shower, getting coffee, making some bite to eat, and you stab them in the head.
That's their own damn fault.
That is.
So, what was I going to say? I noticed at the beginning of the game, I wouldn't mind chatting about this, that the Mastertronic comes up. Is that how he's pronounced
it? Indeed, yes. We have a publisher.
Yeah, I wanted to hear that story.
Well, so we actually hooked up with Mastertronic right at the absolute tail end of Concursion. And technically, they published Concursion as well. Not even technically, okay. They published it. basically we met them through mutual business acquaintances right at the end of Concursion. Like, we had a done, finished product in hand, and they were kind enough to kind of shepherd us out into the world of putting things in stores. And so, I really have no idea about promotion or business, and I am a nerdy programmer. And so, yeah, they popped in and, you know, helped us get the game into the hands of players. And on the back of that, when we were, really anxious to start a new game, really wanted to just dig in, kind of pitched them the idea, and they were generous enough to aid us throughout the process. So they're kind of helping back us on this one a little bit, and they are, going to help us out with promotion and the like.
Yeah, that's cool.
So we are best buddies.
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you. It's, yeah, a lot of people, like, talk crap about the publisher relationship, but honestly, like, it's a great symbiotic relationship for us, because they seem really content to let us, like, dev and do as we please, unless we ask for help, and then they're happy to offer. And on the flip side, I don't know anything about promotion, so they are, you are the first day effectively of our promotion. Like, they've been putting together schedules, and it all kind of kicks off this weekish.
So, we are placed into the annals of time and history.
And then we dovetail into the conventions. It's convention season.
Yes, we were just chatting about how GDC.
Which ones are you guys going to?
I will hopefully try and make it to PAX Prime, but we'll see about that.
It's a long ways away, so there's lots of time to figure out what's going on.
Yeah, which is
September
nice.
Or PAX Prime?
That one is September, yeah. It's the weekend that my classes start back up. So I don't mind missing the first day or two. But yeah, the Seattle is technically closest to us, and that is still like a 16-hour drive.
Yeah. Oh, geez, that's a long drive.
Well, it's because they drive up and over Mount Rainier to get there.
Yeah.
A thing that I'm familiar with. It sounds like a mountain.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like a mountain.
Oh. We're gonna be all over the place starting next week. We're gonna be at PAX East. And then, like, one day after PAX East, I'm going to London for Rez.
Wow.
And then we just found out today that there's a chance we're going to South by Southwest, which is the same days as Rez.
Wow.
So we'll see if we can make that work. We just found out that we might have a cause to go there. And so we'll be figuring that out within the next day or two. Dave and I might split and tag team or something.
I'm gonna tell everyone I made it by myself, though.
That's fine. I'm gonna pretend you don't exist. Even when you're dead. I'm gonna just convince people that you were a ghost that only they can see.
Yeah, and when they start to ask me Java questions, I'm gonna pretty much ruin our reputation.
Just make things up!
Well, I don't know the truth. I don't know how Java works.
You should be like, what? I thought we were talking about our game here, not about code. Yeah.
Anytime anybody says something Cody, just like smile, nod, give him a thumbs up, and go, yeah, coding.
I could just look at
like, I don't know, an example question. Like, so Dave, you know, did you build this framework from scratch? What is this built in? What are you, a nerd? Like, that's just got to be your answer to all those questions.
No, the
can
best
I just
one.
Look
that...
dead in the eye and fart.
No,
can.
The best one that I've ever been told is that if anybody says something that you disagree with, or that you don't want to answer, you just reply with, why do you hate freedom?
Hey, this is America.
I don't know, I was looking around. I thought this was America. Did you?
I'm just looking
That's
at
not
the...
gonna work at res.
I'm looking at the best times right now. How much do you guys hate No Name 1122?
That's me.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's
so
funny.
How much do you hate yourself for being at the top?
Well, they've got Pooba.
I really hate yeah. quite a lot.
Well then, never mind.
No, I don't know if I'm a dirty cheater on that one. I think I just went back and replayed Depth 1 like way after I was too strong for it, you know?
That
I might
makes
be a dirty
sense.
Cheater.
Nothing wrong with a little dirty cheating.
Around to test things, so.
Chainsaw?
No. The chainsaw is a bit too close, although it is fun. Hmm.
Oh, that's my style for sure.
Me Reiki.
Honestly. Kind of sounded like a leaf blower at first. It's like, are you using a vacuum cleaner? What is that?
It's the vacuum cleaner of doom.
Oh, and I have to make a correction. I said something very wrong, and I must apologize. It's really, really big man, not powdered toast man.
Oh, yeah!
Oh, right.
Yeah, I was wondering why you really got a Rocco into Ren and Stimpy, but I thought...
Yeah.
I didn't even, like,
yeah,
think about
really
it.
Powdered toast man was from Ren and Stimpy.
I thought we were yeah. going down the Ren and Stimpy road.
No, it was all about Rocco's mug.
I still, about, like, every week or two, drop just the quote quietly, call the police!
And Heifer. I forgot about Heifer, because he lives with the family of wolves.
Yeah.
They bought him for
I'm
dinner one
adopted!
Time.
Remember that episode? It, like, destroyed his entire world.
Yep.
Because Rocco came over for supper.
Man, this is such a topical conversation
and
that I'm sure nobody's getting.
A full existential crisis because he...
I'm gonna bring it back to the modern day. Ready? What do you think's gonna win, VHS or Beta?
Well, you see, here's the thing. I watched a video on that.
I'm all about the Laserdisc.
Basically, the differences were the shipping weight and the cost.
I was here for pornography.
While Betamax was the superior film quality, it can only hold an hour of footage.
Yeah, so is HD DVD.
Yeah, represent.
Yeah.
I have an HD DVD windbreaker somewhere in the room.
Nice.
My old roommate bought an HD DVD player for his Xbox 360.
And they come with it.
No, not when they first came out. You had to buy it separately.
Oh, God, I hate that movie after working at a sound store. Hiya! Suck arrow! If I can hit.
Nice. That's called professionalism there.
So how many weapons are in this game?
26.
26? Holy crap.
27 if you count your fists.
I got my fist, yeah.
28. I got lefty and righty.
28?
Jack Johnson and Tim O'Neary.
Play your cards right, you can meet the whole crew.
Ooh, tell him to hit tab, Danny.
With the weather what? Oh, tell yeah. We've got, you know, them weekly patches, but we've got a little secret in there right now. Just if you hit tab, it'll tell you what room and how much time you spent in this run so far. But it only works in the dungeon. Yeah. It toggles, but it only shows in the dungeon.
My God, you're Mickey!
I vastly enjoy the fact that you guys take your games seriously, but you don't take your games seriously.
Yeah, we take protection
seriously.
We are extremely professional. We are nothing if not business. We are made of business.
Even the best serious games have a good amount of humor, I find.
Yeah.
I'm telling you guys, watching that show now is a completely different experience.
I'll bet it is.
I'm thinking through all of Rocco kind of in order. Wasn't the restaurant they'd always eat at the Choky Chicken?
Yep. Oh my god, it was.
As well, the big heads, they had this whole, like, fetish thing or something going on. I can't remember what it was, but I remember it was Nessie. We should really get off of Rocko's Modern Life, though. Nobody freaking knows that show.
They should. Yes, yeah, that's the thing. Come on, with writing like this, how can you not?
Good God.
Do they do hourly rates?
Yes.
Yeah, dirty, dirty show.
Spunky.
Right?
It's Spunky.
I didn't even think of that. His dog is named Spunky.
Yep.
Yeah, Nickelodeon was really good at getting away with some of the weirdest stuff.
They ever.
Yeah, I don't know how they did that.
The only one that was...
The
only one that was crazier than that at the time was Animaniacs, and they got away with some really, really crazy stuff.
So, obviously, it's pretty early into the development, but do you guys have any idea for price point or platform?
I think we do. So platform, it's going to be PC and Mac. I don't know where all stores, because I'm bad at business, will be at, but I know that we're planning to release our first public demo, which is going to contain the entirety of the first depth and a handful of the upgrades and things from the second.
Cool.
In about a month, maybe less.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
We can say for sure we will be on Steam. That's worth saying, right?
We will be, yeah. Indeed.
Definitely. I wonder, how does that go? Like, now that you have one successful Steam launch, do you just go like, hey, Steam, we want to do stuff, and they're like, okay.
Sup, Steam? You're looking pretty swole.
Could be. Honestly, I'm really happy for Mastertronic because Greenlight was terrifying the first time, and because we have a publisher, we actually don't need to do it, which I kind of feel like even a jerk for saying, because like so many great games do, and it feels like cheating to have a publisher. It's nice. But indeed, they are doing that heavy lifting for us, which honestly, it was really a load off to know that going in, that our publisher can make that happen, like early in dev, because for Concursion, it was, you know, a year of development, and even in the 12th month, it was like, well, I hope we can get in some stores, because we hadn't done any outreach, and like, until we put it up on Greenlight and started that process, we had no idea what to expect whatsoever.
Wow.
And plus, we didn't have the APIs until late, too.
Oh yeah, we didn't have the Steam APIs until we were Greenlight. So, you know, we built that all as last thing for achievements and whatnot.
Crazy. Another quick question.
Terrifying.
The chainsaw dudes, are they... I just noticed that they all have masks on. Are they, like, inspired by, Texas Chainsaw Massacre?
Not as such, but there's four different masks. One is an anime girl, one is, like, a Jason hockey mask, one is a monkey mask. Danny, what's the fourth one? I don't remember.
We've got the anime girl, the monkey, the paper plate, and the hockey mask.
Right. The paper plate is one.
Yeah, we were just throwing a lot of them around, and we knew it had to be, like... Well, originally, I think we went with the hockey mask, and then we were just brainstorming masks and chose all of them.
That's where Mike Shanks, our art director.
Oh, yeah.
I don't think we were intended to get four masks, really, from him.
Not originally.
He's showing us his concepts. We're like, yes, these, all of them, please. Get those in multiples.
I'm looking to see if I can find the collateral for these guys. I don't know. You're a smarty pants, and I don't know where to look.
I'm so focused on the gameplay, I can't even think about
it. It's really cool,
right now.
Isn't it?
I think you're really cool.
You know who's cool?
Oh, you!
Yeah. Oh, stop!
That is still probably the biggest romance was ever started, if anybody wants to go and watch our Concursion episode.
Yeah, you guys fell in love on it.
Everybody, we sure did.
I don't think there's anything going on right now. Everybody just go through the archive and watch it now.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the easiest way to do it. Just watch every Average Giants cover.
That would be lovely.
Click all the ads.
Yes.
How does that work on Hitbox? Does that help you guys?
With Hitbox, it does, definitely. We also have the subscribe button. Because it's
okay,
on
yeah.
the... Yeah. And the subscribe button is for the whole team, for the whole IGM team, which I think consists of myself. But we won't get into that.
I'm not on IGM.
Yeah.
You're what? You're dead?
Hmm?
I mean, let's not talk about it. It seems like we're not talking about
No, it's all good. Spear. Chainsaw. I want to upgrade my chainsaw because I love it.
But Danny, I should Trexville wants to know in chat when we knew that Concursion was a success.
Ah, that's a good question.
When did you know that?
When did I know that? I'm... Today? I don't know. You calling it a success is kind of nice.
Yeah.
I mean, that really kind of... That feels good. I'm warm inside. I don't know. Concursion's still an ongoing project. I would now say, if I'm being really honest, that it was like blow off the doors, huge, you know, groundbreaking success. But I'm really happy that, like, we were able to, you know, see it to conclusion, get it out in people's hands. People seem to like it. So, I mean, it's not like we're rolling in them fatty bucks right now. I wouldn't say it like a huge, but from like both a personal, professional level and also like people seem to enjoy it. It's kind of an ongoing success. I don't know. Whenever somebody plays it and seems to enjoy it, that's really fulfilling. So, every day, you're calling it a success is the success.
There you go.
It's been on Average Giant, so it's a success.
Wow. We're like the Weird Al of indie games now. Apparently.
We make fun of everything and get paid for it? Sweet!
That's probably one of the best answers to that question I've heard. Trex has asked that before.
Yeah? Yeah, no, that's my honest answer. It's not like, you know, the honest answer is it did just well enough for us to be able to do a second game and know that it wasn't a bad idea, and that felt really good, that, you know, we could sustain. And I really like the game. I just think it's a ton of fun. So I'm happy with it for that reason alone.
And we were recently included in a Humble Bundle, and that was cool.
Yeah, that was really cool.
It was downright awesome.
Congrats on that as well.
Thank you.
What did you guys learn from making Concursion when you started going to wanting to make your second game?
I think I learned a handful of things. Definitely, like, I'm not visually oriented. And so I think, like, I learned that spending a little bit more time and effort and slowing down on art can, you know, make a really big difference. I think we learned a little bit more. I say I'm terrible at promotion, which is absolutely true, but I think I learned a little bit more that it should be on our shoulders. We, you know, worked with a PR company for a while on Concursion, and I think it was a good learning experience. But in the end, I think us being responsible for it is, I don't know, both the most honest and like the truest way to get it done. You know, I learned that I am impatient with putting my fate in anyone else's hands. If someone else speaks about our game, I will almost inevitably interrupt the crap out of them.
Plus, we're on Twitter now. We learned to use Twitter.
Yes!
Holy crap!
I saw that!
Tweetiest.
Yeah, that's... That... Oh, who was it that we were... Oh, yeah. The guys who did Vanish. Three Drunk Men.
Oh, yeah, Three Drunk Men.
They're very difficult to get a hold of. By means besides email.
Yeah,
because they don't have a Twitter at all.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So
Twitter became kind of where I tell people to find us lately.
Yes, Twitter's very useful if you can do it right.
It's
not that hard to do it right.
That's really how I got my start was Twitter.
Yeah, if it wasn't for Twitter, I wouldn't be a post whore.
Oh god! Oh, that was close.
Whew.
Oh, I got the perfect picture for what they just said.
I'm curious.
Get it out, let's do this.
Oh, man.
So, Mr. Average Giant, what is your favorite weapon so far, having only cleared the first step?
Probably the chainsaw.
See what I just did?
Excuse me, princess!
Oh my god.
Why so long, Link? Well, excuse me!
I'm not sure if it's a... Your thing can't be making jokes from TV shows that nobody gets. You know what you are right now? You're my dad.
Oh god, I'm doing dad jokes now?
Yeah!
I'm extremely proud of you. Your mother and I both. So how was our experience working with a publisher different than going solo? I really like it. I don't know. I want Dave to answer this question too, because we might not have the same experience on it. But I really like it. It's really nice to know that, like, somebody, you know, like I said, we worked briefly with like a PR company last time, but it's different because you're kind of paying someone and they don't have the same investment. So it's nice to know that somebody has our back in like a more day-to-day invested way. It's nice to know that the game is going to come out on Steam and all sorts of stores, and that there's no fear that like it won't come out anywhere. Like when I was looking for playtesters, they were able to round some peeps up. It's kind of a nice support net. At no point, like I alluded to earlier, like I feel like publishers often have a bad reputation for like getting involved and corrupting the creative product and requiring all sorts of weird changes. But like, I just have not felt that way at all. You know, it's been really collaborative. They've been really happy to just let us do our production, set our own dates, and, you know, move however we see fit.
Oh, so they didn't even give you a deadline or anything?
No, well, we ended up giving them one. Like, both Dave and I come from, like, a hardcore, really date-oriented production background in post-production. Mm-hmm. And so, like, before we started, it was never really that big. We knew, like, we wanted to be done at the end of March. We knew that, you know, we had all these milestones laid out. So part of what I pitched them was a schedule that actually, miraculously, we were fully stuck to, really. I think maybe a 5% slip, if that, like a couple weeks. And so, yeah, no, actually quite the opposite. They're constantly offering us more time, and I'm constantly reassuring them that we don't need it.
Wow.
So I feel like this game is, it's concursion with us as well, but this game is sort of an allegory for the inside of Danny's psyche. Like, he cannot stop. He has to always be going. You know, so like he's the guy that's driving like this whole thing, and he's picking up virtual weapons as soon as they break as he goes. Like, Danny won't say nice things about himself because he's modest, but he's really like, he is the real deal. He can sit down and just make stuff out of absolute dust, and it's like grand quality. So I don't know. I'm a fan of you, Danny.
Uh-huh. Aww. I'm a fan of you, Dave. I'm a fan of all of you.
I'm so glad that this has been such a positive experience for you guys too. This game, personally to me, it does feel like the next step. Like it definitely, you can see a lot of the influence from your previous game.
Yeah.
But it does seem like this is, it's shown a lot of growth from where Concursion was, if that makes sense.
No, thank you. No, I appreciate that. I agree.
Well, when it comes to the games with the same developer, I mean, you want to make, you'd almost hope for them to keep sort of themselves in it.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I feel only, like we try to establish a voice.
Yeah,
definitely.
Obnoxious and high-pitched.
No, it's the cohesive narrative of having to always be in motion and always moving forward, and slowing down or stopping is like, it's deadly. Mm-hmm. And that's if we had a corporate motto, it would be that, only more eloquent. I don't know, I'm tired.
No, that's very well said. I think that encapsulates Concursion as well, or quite well as well.
So Dave, how is it different for you working for a publisher?
So I come from, you know, a different generation than you youngsters, and and also I have a music background, so ever since I was a little kid, I just wanted to be like, you know, legitimate, like on a label, like with a label. And I do feel that way with Mastertronic, especially because of the way that they act and the way that they are. They're like all cool people and they have cool ideas. And like Danny said, they don't limit us. So I don't know. I feel like they make me feel like a rock star.
Nice.
I like star. So I dig it. But actually, sure. Danny does almost all of the communicating with them. So I just like see emails after the fact and I go, yeah, those guys are cool.
It's really nice to have a good experience with a publisher, because they do get a lot of flack, and I find it's a lot of the horror stories that you hear from publishers. You don't hear a lot of the fact that, like, the service they provide. What they do provide is quite a good service, and it's something that can be needed, especially with game developers or people that aren't used to selling their own product.
Well, a lot of the horror stories come from delays in payment, where the people, you know, the developers on their end are not, let's say, business people, and they don't understand that sometimes it takes a while for that stuff to come through, And then they allege, you know, all sorts of things, and the publisher's like, well, screw you.
I'm sure it happened.
You know.
Didn't that happen with the Xbox Live?
I'm not saying there's no publishers that just straight up steal, but I haven't been
done. That's what I want to do. That sounds like a great gig, right? Work in games and just steal.
Yep, I'm in.
Dude, you could totally be the Albert Einstein of games.
Right?
Oh yeah,
because
I just went there.
Steal revenue from the indie devs.
Yep.
My son is known for that.
He is really ahead of his time.
Yeah, come on. He invented the AMC.
The what?
No, he invented the sequel.
Oh.
Like a server?
Oh!
Yeah, the AMC 2.
I think this whole conversation just totally derailed. But
is
I like it.
A thing? Is that a thing? What's an AMC?
Equals MC squared.
Oh, yeah, the
M. Have you never seen Young Einstein?
I am just realizing how many references to old movies you make. You are that kind of dad. You're going to be, like, referencing Ed Sullivan to your kids and be like, ah, your kids don't watch TV.
You know what's stupid is that most of these references I made were back from when I was between 4 and 8 years old.
How old are you now?
I'm 30. I'm 30, and the majority of my references come from the mid-90s and late 80s, which is the weirdest part.
Okay, so Trexel asks again. Trexel, we need to get you on the show as just a host so you can, like, ask the questions for us. Do you guys have your own personal expectations of how good your game is going to do, or is that already set by your publisher? Or is it just up in the air?
I have
no idea.
Ask
them how well they think it's going to do, because I don't know.
They must have some sort of charts or models saying this is how good we expect it to be. Unless you're just like, you know, if it sells a copy, whatever.
Whatever, bro.
I have no idea. Like, I don't know. Concursion did maybe as well, or maybe a little, like, if I'm being candid, not as well as I hoped it might, but that definitely tints my, like, expectations of this one in, like, that I'm really hesitant. Like, I don't know at all. I hope people really like and play it and enjoy it, but I also hope we get to make a third game. So, I have no idea. I think if you ask me that question in 2 or 3 weeks, I'm gonna have an altogether different answer after we're done with PAX and done with REST.
Okay.
But it's like a mystery.
I'll set a Twitter for like 2 weeks from now.
An automated Twitter message to you in 2 weeks.
How well did Concursion do? Give you some numbers. I don't actually know how many. I don't know how many units we sold. I should know that. That's something I should know. I don't even know how much money we made.
We have the humble numbers, maybe.
Do we even have a bank account? Like,
right?
Oh, wait, you're off the hook. He's just kidding.
Well, no, I'll answer a little. To the best of my ability, I can't really answer. I'm done with business. Apparently, I'm horrible with it.
I think during Humble, we moved like 20,000 or more.
I think almost 30.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
But that absolutely...
So it pays your rent for a couple months. So that's good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's amazing, though. Congratulations, man. I saw when you guys hit the Humble Bundle, and that was cool. It was just neat.
It was surreal, because you know us. And it was surreal for me, because I know us.
So if Humble chooses that, or what?
That was actually Mastertronics, baby, again. They set that whole deal up. We had been talking to a couple other, bundle places, and kind of honestly was a bit intimidated of that one, but, you know, kind of planning to reach out. And I was talking to Mastertronic, and they set that sucker up. So again, thank you to them.
Advantage.
And now we pause for a word from our sponsor.
Here at Mastertronic.
Come and get some Wendy's. If you enjoy the double baconator heart attack, come to Wendy's.
Hey, I noticed something crazy about Wendy's the other day that I have to tell you guys about, because I don't have anyone else to talk to. She's not. On the Wendy's. Oh, go perfect.
Why is it saying mom? Is she the mom? Did it
Holy
mom?
Shit. Danny, that's what I noted, because that's what I was going to say. Is that necklace spells out mom. I'm not even kidding.
Oh, really?
How creepy is that?
That's probably a marketing thing. Where well, it's like, okay, you know, so you're safe and secure with your mother, so we should
that could
it
be
there.
A marketing thing, but there actually is a picture of her back when she was with, like, Wendy is Dave's daughter.
Yeah.
And back when she was, like, one of the original pictures of the family, she was wearing this, like, weird blue, like, I don't even know what you call it, like, pleated shirt and, like, a little gold pendant. That's pretty much what it was.
Did that
right,
gold
but
pendant
look,
say
look
mom?
Look at how they specifically styled yeah. it, though. It totally says mom.
Yeah. I bet you it's marketing.
Does it always say mom? It's not Mother's Day, is it, right? I'm not that bad a son.
What?
No, there.
No. I had to think about it.
You figured that out. Yeah, there, that's what it was. Like.
Oh, snap. Yeah, it totally says mom.
Maybe it says nom. Maybe it says nom, huh?
Is it? Oh, now it means you're I'm eating. Sure. I was positive at a glimpse, but now I'm
like, if it said nom, it wouldn't be a palindrome. It's equal on those sides.
Son of a bitch, I palindrome, I.
Oh, I knew somebody was going to say that. Yes.
A man playing a canal, Panama. That's my only palindrome. Most of our units sold in the first few months are evenly, really evenly throughout. I'd say even now it's fairly steady. In fact, right now it's moving more than it did our first month.
Okay, that's one question I would ask, is we had some guests on the show, the guys behind See No Evil. We had them on just like 2 or 3 weeks ago. And they mentioned that once they had dropped their price, that the sales like obviously spiked. But
yeah,
they felt like... how do you guys judge your value of the game? Is that something the publisher does for the price point?
They, for Concursion, like I said, we got them involved late in the game, and so they, I think, weren't quite as invested from that standpoint, having not invested in it up front.
Mm-hmm.
We decided 15 to begin with, and I think that was probably too high. I think we're kind of an unknown quantity as a developer. You know, it's not like we've got a name brand or recognition. Our game is weird, and it's, you know, kind of purposely difficult and niche. So, I don't know, I think maybe 15 was a bit high, so we ended up lowering it to 10. Right now, the price of Concursion is 10. I think Weaponographist, don't quote me, but I think we're looking at roughly 10.
Interesting. And that's it's interesting to me because I always view most of the games we have on the show as worth more than what they end up selling for on Steam.
Yeah. Well, it's a really competitive marketplace, though. Like,
yeah.
Again, like, we've got a game out there, we've got some views, maybe a little bit of name recognition, not a ton, but some. But at the same time, it's like, if we go up for, say, $20, there's no dodging the fact that half the rest of the games in the indie section are going to be half that cost. And
and you can also get, like, every Final Fantasy for, like, $40 in some of these
right?
bundles.
Yeah.
Like, we're going against AAAs at low price points as well.
Yep. And we just had two of our guests actually launch on Steam in the last week. On the same day, the guys behind Reassembly and Eric Asmussen behind Robot Roller Derby.
Although
it
wasn't on
Dodgeball.
The same day, okay.
Yeah. And they got onto the new features.
Nice. Awesome.
And because of that, like, they're in the top sellers list still. But with both of them, I noticed, like, Disco Dodgeball, I think, is, like, $7 right now.
Okay.
Or something like that.
Oh, and here's another thing that Disco...
Reassembly is $17. Which I thought was interesting because I would have reversed that. So it's this weird space that it's hard to define, I find. It's really hard to define.
I think a lot of it is defined by what you can pull more than what you necessarily think you're worth. You know, if you've got a beautiful 60-hour RPG, but, you know, you don't have name recognition, and you're not, you know, your promotion didn't hit the way you want, dropping the price can be a way to counter that.
Mm-hmm.
Sale tactics are so randomized. Like, one thing that Eric did that with Disco Dodgeball that I don't know if I've heard any other game do, he gave away 400,000 copies.
Oh, jeez, that is a ton.
Or was it 200,000?
Where did you find that many people?
Over a week, a weekend or a week or something,
what?
He gave away a couple hundred thousand copies of the game.
Because I know
how
the
does
guys
he know
see the
people to give copies?
I think he just, like, for example, one day he gave me 25 copies, and then he gave another guy 50 copies. And the one weekend he gave, honestly, I think he said, not 400, I think it was about 125,000 copies only.
So that's like the mixtape philosophy. You're not mixtape, but like Metallica gave out one of their own albums for free on tape cassettes in the 80s. They just gave out like tens of thousands of copies of it and helped them get their name out.
And then the other thing I'm thinking about is it must be an interesting tactic for some game developers to, like, it almost sounds like you'd possibly benefit from selling your game at a slightly inflated price from what you wanted and then proceed to roll it to that price.
Totally, yeah, we definitely see, and I've heard from a lot of people that when it comes, not even just like big sales, like Steam sales, but like generally speaking, you're allowed, you know, on most stores to drop your price periodically and call it a sale.
Yeah.
The sales spike. Like, and I think it's because it appears on, you know, discount lists and things like that. We'll find that, like, sites list our game that wouldn't have 2 days before, not because of the game, but because it's, you know, on sale. And so, yeah, just... Oh, no. Nick. Nick's being secretive. I saw you quit. No, you're still...
You can fight
one.
The boss.
Oh, no, it's all good.
Yeah, you hit level 3 in terms of strength, but you're not...
Oh!
So we refer
that's
to...
That's why Nick just aborted.
I was being so paranoid about it.
Our wishes did not reveal too much.
Yeah.
Yeah, we refer to the various, let's call them acts, we refer to them as depths of the dungeons. There's, mm-hmm. there's, you know, you were on depth 1.
The second
one.
Boss. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's... I was wondering, because I kept looking at it, and I'm like, why the hell am I level... in level 2 already. So I anyway, continue. Go ahead. I also noticed that we're at like about 9:10 right now, so that was the other reason I went back to town.
Yeah.
No, it's 8:09.
Oh, yes.
You're
yes,
in the wrong time zone.
I'm so sorry.
What was the time to
stuff? Pretty quick here, yeah. So I wouldn't mind just wrapping it up, but we can still have a nice little conversation for the next few minutes.
Can we watch the opening cutscene just because I like it?
Yeah. Of course. Is there a way for me to do that from here?
If you go back to the start menu, it'll replay every 45 seconds if you just idle on the start menu.
Sure.
Otherwise, it's kill and start the game. You can go to the start menu just by walking out of town to the top left.
Oh, I didn't even know that. But anyway, we're relaunching the game. But yeah, let's watch the intro because, again, the art in this game is amazing. I love the animations, but the intro is beautiful.
Dave is doing the sound effects tomorrow. We're starting
on. Oh, sweet.
Yeah.
I thought you were going to plug yourself for some voice acting right there.
Oh. Hi.
Yeah. Come on.
If you need somebody that has a voice like ours, we will be glad to do some voice acting work for you.
Lol.
Was that not what you wanted?
Yeah, there you go. I just kind of assumed you would.
No, I wouldn't. I wouldn't tell people that we're totally available to be commissioned for some voice acting if you want.
Everybody in chat and on YouTube right now. Yeah. Okay, here we go. Mastertronic. At Mastertronic, there they have a Twitter. I'm glad you guys got into Twitter. And yes, you can play this game with a controller. Okay, here we go. Sorry. We could read it.
It's your legendary hunter.
When suddenly, pineapples.
Master McGrave over here really is you. Our town is overrun with demonic presence without your well renowned skill. I'm not even reading this now.
Then it's your lucky day, gross witch lady. Point me to the demons and I'll show me the gold.
Oh, demons, we have plenty of gold, however, none. Is that a woman? Oh, it is. Could you not take a small bit of pity on us?
Ha! Worst pitch I've ever heard. I've got more promising wealthy friends to save.
Dick. Oh, I didn't even see that. Gold you demand! Riches you crave not, curse you, Doug McGrave. Until you choose to save our town, your powers of poverty will crumble down.
Dwah! Face.
Why do you do this?
Oh. Hmm. Witches. What am I supposed to do now?
Save our town, you jerk!
The weaponographist. So, the amazing intro. I love that.
I love you.
I love you too.
Shout out to Joseph Rintoul. the artist who rendered all of those characters that you saw in the opening cutscene there. I have a feeling that Ren and Stimpy were among his influences, I feel.
Yeah.
Like, yeah. Vibe from it.
But which is awesome. Amazing.
We were really lucky to find that guy.
All right. That has been a sneak peek of the Weaponographist, which you guys can look forward to in the next little while. I'm not going to lock down a date, obviously. But will be coming out soonish. Make sure to check it out on Steam. We'll be posting a link. If you're watching this on YouTube, there's at least a link to the Steam community page right down below. and I just wanted to thank both the Poopas again for being on here. And we would love to have you guys on for launch or sure. any other major updates you guys have.
For sure.
Of course.
Yeah.
So, happy
yeah.
to be
yeah.
here.
Wicked.
Yeah. What did you think, by the way, Giant?
Well, considering that when I'm totally immersed in a game and excited by it and just enjoy it, I have a tendency to not be able to say much.
Yeah, that does kind of happen. It happens to me a lot, too.
It's a good thing that you were playing it, because at least I was able to say some stuff. Because if I was playing it, you'd just see me like this. I would just be like... Yeah,
that is
just...
your streaming face now, isn't it? That's why I don't stream much. Yeah.
No, I just put it at random camera angles to make it so at least people are entertained. So it's just like, I'm just like this. Whoa.
Lovely. All right. But it is now 9:15 our time. So I'm going to have to say goodbye. I want to thank you guys again. We'll keep in touch, obviously. And you can check out Twitter. You can check out the Poopas Twitter. I'll link that in the description below as well. Hopefully, if you guys want to post it in chat, I'll be my guest. And from everybody here at Average Giants and everybody here at Indie Game Magazine, much love, and I guess we'll see y'all next week.
Bye. Oh, bye.
Bye. Bye.
Oh.
Bye.